about my attitude, my blessing. And I just want to talk to you about changing our attitude, not as just individuals. Hey, Logan. He was looking, then he turned his head. He is getting big. He's staring at me, staring a hole in me. But I just want to talk to you not just as individuals, but as a church, changing our attitude and changing our blessing. Amen? Amen. Oh, you got quiet already.
Amen.
I ain't changing nothing. You're the one I'm talking to. Ain't gonna tell me what to change. You know, I always do this to Cody when Cody's with me. So I'll say, "You guys have a nice day." And I'll say, "Don't tell me what kind of day to have." You know, but that's how some people live. Yeah. Merry Christmas. Ah, I was so merry. Yeah. Happy holidays. Not for me. It's not. You know, so that's how some people live. But we need to change our attitude. And if we change our attitude, it changes our blessing. Our blessing is dependent upon our attitude. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our attitude restrains us from many blessings that God has for us. Amen. Now, y'all get with me this morning. I had to preach in a week. I'm about to die. Yeah. So hear me just say. You guys have to understand that God is only looking to bless you. He's not looking to curse you. Some of y'all don't believe that.
Come on.
How do you get the cursings of God? Read the things that God hates. Here again, I got another teachable moment. Here we go. Listen. How does God curse you? When you do the things that God says, if you do those things, I will curse you. It's not very hard to figure that out. I know I'm not a great scholar. I'm not a know-it-all, but I'm a know-it. Something. And I know I'm not this great, I don't know, theologian guy. But you know who I am? I'm pretty smart about when somebody tells me, if you do this, I will curse you. If you do this, I will bless you. And I'm figuring out how to be blessed, and I go, maybe I should do the curse thing. No! That just is just ignorant. And so we need to understand that God is always looking to bless you. He's not looking to curse you. His desire is not to curse you. His desire is that you live blessed. That you, beloved, I wish that of all things I may prosper in health, and as your soul prospers. He wants you to be prosperous, but he wants you to do this. He wants your soul to prosper. He wants you to be what God has called you to be. He wants you to be a child of His and not just flailing around and hoping that you land on the right spot. He's looking for you to have an attitude of gratitude and an attitude of blessing, because if you don't have those things, you're a miserable wretch to be around, number one. Oh, you have to love me. Yeah, but I don't have to like your tail. Okay, all right, but here's... I'm just kidding. Y'all look at me like, really? Listen, I don't have to like the way you act about certain things. I don't have to, listen, for me to love you doesn't mean I agree with everything you do.
Amen.
How many in here have a spouse or had a spouse or wish you had a spouse or don't want a spouse? Okay. All right. Hear me. Whenever you were married, you probably didn't agree, or if you are married, you probably didn't agree with everything your spouse did. Can I get a witness? So did you say, "I hate you, I'm leaving"? No. No. Not the first time. Okay. But here's the deal. We learn that we have differences. If we are in the church, I'll guarantee you. How many are in the church this morning? Okay, cool. If you have differences with somebody sitting next to you, guarantee you do. Somebody sitting right next to you, they don't do everything the way you think they ought to do it, and you sure enough don't do everything the way they think you ought to do it, and that guy up there preaching, he sure enough doesn't do everything the way I think he ought to do it. And so we have differences, but our attitude has to be, I don't care. I'm going to love the Lord. I'm going to do what God has called me to be. I'm going to do what God's called me to do. I'm going to be a blessing and not a curse. stress. I'm going to bless people instead of stress people. Somebody help me out this morning. The attitude, this is the attitude that I don't understand and I don't get. And maybe it's the way I was raised. I don't know. Maybe that switching took effect. I don't know. But here's the attitude that I never have understood. The attitude of never me. Always somebody else, never me. Anybody ever had that attitude? I've had the attitude before. I'm not saying I've never had it, but I get out of it real quick. And the reason I get out of it real quick is because God says in His Word that He's no respecter of person. If He'll do it for Paul, He'll do it for me. If He'll do it for John the Baptist, He'll do it for me. If He'll do it for whoever, name your favorite television preacher, if he'll do it for them, He'll do it for me. If He'll bless that church, He'll bless this one. If He'll bless those people, He'll bless me. If He'll bless that family, He'll bless my family. If He'll touch it, He'll heal. If He'll heal this one, He'll heal that one.
Amen.
But brother, your brother died. I know. I understand that. You don't have to remind me of that. I think about him every day. But how can you preach that? Because I don't look at the Word of God through the prism of my experiences. My experiences will lie to me. The Word of God will not lie. My experiences are this. My experiences are, hey, maybe it wasn't the right place, maybe I wasn't whatever. My experiences have to line up perfectly with the Word of God. And sometimes my experiences are different than what the Word of God says. And so I can't look at God's Word and say, well, because it didn't happen to me, it's not true. I can't look at it that way. Cannot. I have to look at it as whether it happened to me or not, God's Word is true. God is faithful. No matter if I'm faithful or not, God is faithful. God is righteous whether I'm righteous or not. God is on the throne and I'm not. God is God and I'm not. His ways are different than my ways. His thoughts are different than my thoughts. And why God wants to do things He does, I don't know. But I would have found, if you look at the crucifixion of Jesus, you think, God, really, that's the best plan you could come up with? Is having your son beat the snot out of him on a cross for a bunch of people that hated him? That's the best plan you could come up with? I venture to guess most of us would not do that. Most of us would come up with a different way. But God came up with the perfect way. Hello. Check 1, 2. Y'all looking at me like I'm stupid. Maybe I am. All right. The attitude of never me. I don't get it. Get out of that attitude. It'll never happen to me. It'll never happen for me. It'll never. The devil's a liar. God is a blessing God. He blesses you and He blesses those who bless. Listen, I'll never have or I'll never receive that from the Lord. Listen, it kills our effectiveness to receive from the Lord. If you walk around saying, I'll never have it. If you walk around and you say, I'll never receive that. Then you won't, prophet. You just prophesied it into your life, and God respected you enough to give you your prophecy, prophet. I'll never get that. Amen, God will say. And He'll never give it to you. I'll never receive what God has for me. You're right. But if you'll get out of that funk, if you'll get out of that, listen, it kills our effectiveness to receive from the Lord if we just simply do not do what God says to do, and that is keep our minds upon Him and continually study after His Word. Listen, we will never have what we think we won't have.
Amen.
Oh, Jeff wants to build a church. First of all, it ain't Jeff's church. I hear that all the time. It is God's house. It is His tabernacle. The word sanctuary and I, we have a hard time. Why is that? Well, the sanctuary is a hiding place of safety.
Yeah.
Right.
A tabernacle is a place of praise.
Yeah.
Right. I ain't hiding from nobody.
Amen.
Bless the Lord,
yeah.
Oh my soul. I didn't come to church to hide in a safe place. I understand we have times in our lives where we just need a lone place with God and we need a place to get along with God. I get it. But sanctuary and tabernacle to me are two different terms.
Amen.
A sanctuary is a place of I'm hiding, and we call this a sanctuary, I call it a tabernacle. Because listen, we come into this house and we're to worship God. You can get out of a lot of stuff by your praise. You can get out of a lot of funk by your praise. You can get out of a lot of things by praising the Lord.
Amen.
You can touch God, and God will touch you, I promise you. Listen, if you think you're cursed, then you will be cursed.
Right.
If you think you are blessed, then you will be blessed. How many walk around here blessed? I walk around blessed every day. I'm on blessed. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed coming out. I'm blessed in the basket. I'm blessed in my store. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. And God didn't give it to me just because He likes me better than you. That has nothing to do with it. It's I read the Bible. The Bible says, if you do this, I will bless you. If you do this, I will curse you. I tend to stay away from the curse. It said the devil will curse you. It said God will curse you. If you do these things, I will have no choice but to curse you. You'll have no choice but to go cut your own switch. And it better not break. That are the instructions. I don't know if I'm preaching to anybody this morning. Listen to me. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know all your troubles and trials. But I do understand this one thing. That if we will do what the Word of God says to do, then He is bound by His Word to do what He says He will do. Either blessing or cursing. And whatever. If I will do what He says to do in the blessing part, I will be blessed. If I do what He says not to do and I will be cursed, then I will be cursed. It's simple. Yeah. Well, now, brother, I tried that once. Yeah, I did it too once. I tried it once, and I tried it again. And I did it again. Well, I paid my tithe and I gave my offering once, and nothing changed. That's not what it's about. It's a lifestyle. It's a heart thing. It's a spirit thing. Listen, you will not get me not to pay my tithe. You will not. You can't talk me out of it. I'm going to pay. I'm going to give my offerings. I don't care. Listen, I'm going to do what God says do. I'm going to be blessed on this earth. And I'm going to be blessed in heaven. I'm going to be blessed here. I'm going to live a life of blessing. Many of you want miracles in your life. I would rather live in blessing than in miracles. Because miracles mean you're in trouble. I got to have a miracle. But if you live in blessing, or blessing, I didn't say you would never go through nothing. My brother Jeff, you said you're blessed. Yeah. But I thought your brother passed away with cancer. He did. I'm still blessed. I thought your brother Tishamigo has seizures and is messed up. He is. But I'm still blessed. I thought, wait a minute, that your mother, she has a problem with her knee and has diabetes. Yeah. Still blessed. It's my attitude. I could have thrown in the towel. God, you didn't heal my brother, you don't love me. God, you didn't heal my brother Tishamingo, you don't love me. God, my mother's still sick. We pray that we have enough oil on her head that she can't even put a cap on. It slides over her eye. And we pray for her, we pray for her, pray for her. Nothing ever changed. I can throw the towel in and say, oh, that's it. God, you're a liar. Or my attitude could be, God, regardless of what happens in my prison, of my understanding of what I see, it doesn't matter. My attitude is this, that I've seen testimony after testimony after testimony after testimony how God has healed people, set people free, delivered people. I need to inspect me. And we need to inspect ourselves as a church as to why God, it doesn't seem like God's miracles are happening. You know, it ought to be a surprising thing when it doesn't happen than when it does. It ought to be a surprising thing to us. Why didn't it happen? Why didn't he get up? Why didn't my brother, why isn't my brother healed this morning? Why? It ought to be a surprising thing to us, and we ought to get mad about it not happening instead of, okay, never mind. I'll go on. People who always see themselves as the victim. She left me. No one likes me. My car broke down. The rent's never going to get paid. Etc. You've heard it. You've never, you know. You've heard it. You will always be downhearted. If that's your attitude, you will always be downhearted. You'll never see anything but loss in your lives. You'll never see a blessing. You'll always see the bad thing. Listen, God can bless you abundantly. And if one thing doesn't happen, you focus on the one thing. You may have had the best Thanksgiving meal you've ever had. You may have had enough money to go this morning to Carl's Jr. You may have had enough money this morning to go somewhere. You've had enough money to get gas this morning in your car. You had enough money to do whatever it is that you needed to do. And all of a sudden, now this one thing happens, and now God hates you and the whole church hates you. What is wrong with us? We can't understand this. You live. How many slept in a house this evening, this last night, this past evening? You slept in a house? How many had heat? Well, praise God. God hates you, doesn't he? How many had food last night and this morning? How many had too much food last night and this morning? How many had enough money to stop and get you something to drink this morning on the way into church? How many had an opportunity to drive a car to church this morning that had gas in it? Everybody almost under the sound of my voice had the opportunity. Boy, God hates us. How many have a cell phone? You know you don't have a constitutional right to a cell phone? Anyway, you don't have to have a cell phone to live. Knees up, Jack. Okay, you don't have to have those things to live, but you have to have shelter, food, and water. And God has given us a blessing. God has blessed us beyond the compare. This church is blessed coming in and going out. This church is so blessed that we waste blessing at McDonald's. We waste blessing on every other stupid, trivial thing that we want to buy. And we buy stuff because we think God has blessed us to gather stuff. Hallelujah! That's good preaching, brother. Thank you. Listen, it is the people that have an attitude of blessing that always gets the next big thing in their life. It's people that have an attitude of blessing. Because listen, I'm not blessed so I can say, look how blessed I am. I'm blessed so I can put it in the house of God and put it in the gospel so it can be preached around the world. That's why I'm blessed. I'm not blessed for my own, just I'm going to get as much as I can get. That's not why I'm blessed. Though God doesn't care if you get stuff. Right. Listen, understand this though. It's all going to burn up. The house that you desire, it's going to burn. The car that you want, nothing. The money that you think you have in your pocket, not worth anything. Because it's all going to go away when that new heaven and new earth come down. It's not going to matter because he's going to be the light. He's going to supply every one of my needs. He already does supply my needs. Listen, I'm just letting you understand this. Get this one. It's the people that have an attitude of blessing that always get the next big thing in their lives. I didn't even pray for it and I got it. You know why? Because you have an attitude of thankfulness for God. God, I thank you for everything that you've given me. I thank you for the blessing in my life. I thank you for my family. I thank you for my health. See, we need to thank God for our health before we get sick and begging to heal us. I'm so thankful that I can get up and I can do what I need to do. I'm so thankful that I don't hurt. I'm so thankful that nothing is wrong with me as far as I know. Some people desire to sound differently than that, but as far as I know, there's nothing physically wrong with me. I don't take a bunch of medicine. I'm 45 and I don't take any prescription drugs. I'm thankful for that. Most of the people I know have 12 pills they take a day, and I'm like, what's that for? High blood pressure, what's that for? Low blood pressure. What's that for? Stress. What's that for? I'm so thankful. I'm thankful for God that I don't have those problems. I'm not picking on you if you have those things. Then let's pray. God, I'm going to continue to take it until you heal me. Until I don't need it anymore, God, I'm going to continue to take it. But I'm going to believe you every day that you're going to heal me. I'm going to believe you every minute of the day that you're going to come and you're going to heal me, God. I didn't tell you to flush your medicine. I said flush your attitude. Get your attitude different. Change the way that you look upon your life. It is the people that have this attitude. They always get things. Listen, this is what people say. You know, the guy said, oh, she left me. The people would get out there and said, I'm glad she's gone. Okay. Hit the road, Jack. Okay. I'm glad. I'm just kidding. Okay. Listen. They are surprised to find out that somebody doesn't like them. Yeah. Right. Oh, nobody likes me. And for somebody with a blessing attitude, they mean they don't like me? Yeah. I thought everybody likes me. Now I gotta go make it right. And so that's an attitude difference. Yeah. I just thought everybody about it. You know, they're not happy they had to spend the money, but they're glad they had the money. Can somebody say amen? Listen, they thank God for the money. Listen, I don't pay rent. I own my own house. Somebody better help me today. I don't have to worry about the rent being paid. I got to worry about the mortgages, but not their... Now, I have four houses, so don't look at me like I have like triple mortgages. And so, understand this. Understand this. That God has blessed me. I use the example all the time of my missionary money, my $2 a month to Brother Nutt in Bolivia. That was the turning point. That was the pivot point in my life. I can trace it back to that $2 that we were faithful to give for 2 years. That is our pivot point. That is the time when it turned around for us. I could have said, oh, it's just $2. They'll never miss it. And they probably wouldn't have. They would have never missed my $2 pledge to Bolivia. It wouldn't have changed one thing in Bolivia.
Yeah.
Nothing. They couldn't even buy a cup of coffee at Starbucks. At McDonald's, they could have got two cups. Okay, listen. But hear me. That was the changing point of our lives financially. Hello. That was the changing point when God saw my wife and I dig change out of the Firebird ashtray to give to our secretary, which was David at that time. When God saw our faithfulness to do that, he said, I can trust him with a little better than that.
Yeah.
And I was able to move from my house on Highland Street. I love Highland Street. It's my favorite street. But we moved from a little shack of a house to a house that had three bedrooms and one bath and two living areas. We didn't even have enough furniture for two living areas. We had a two-car garage. We had an acre of ground. We had a cellar that's dry, that's big as half. No, it's a big old cellar. It's a big old cellar. Anyway, and God blessed me with that for cost. Listen, I bought it from my aunt. True. It's an inside deal. I get it. But she had moved to Seattle and had sit on the market for a year. And she said, if you want it, you can have it. Because I called just making fun of her one day and said, sell your house yet?
Yeah.
And I was just bugging. I never even thought about buying the house. I couldn't afford to buy the house. But God gave us a $35,000 miracle. Because my attitude was, I'm going to be faithful to God. I don't care what God, what the circumstances are. I don't care where we're headed. It looks like we're not going to ever make it. I was working at Wrangler, making a whole $300 a week while I was getting rich. And I'm telling you, we had a baby on the way, I believe. I believe Abby was on the way when we got there. She was born. Who was Adam on the way yet? Yeah. Livia's almost one. I don't remember. It's been a long time. But they were, hey, they were young. I remember now because Adam got mad because we moved it because he wanted his yard back. I remember that. He hated the house over there because it didn't have his yard. Now he said, we live here. Okay, but anyway, he didn't realize how blessed he is. But hear me for just a second. Hear me, please understand. It's an attitude. Man, I'm never going to finish this. It's the attitude. The difference of attitude. It's the difference of, I'm going to bless God. Listen, I'm not telling you all this to say how holy I am, and my feet don't touch the ground, and I'm not that holy. Most of y'all know me all my life. You know I'm not that holy. But it's the attitude, and it's the blessing. The blessing comes with the attitude and the service. Listen, God blessed me with that house, and now it is. Now it is. How many bedrooms is it now? Fixing to be five with three bathrooms. And now I don't have a garage anymore, but the Lord loves you. And it's five bedrooms, three baths, still sits on an acre of ground. It's not the prettiest house in town. It's not the greatest house in town, but it's a house that God gave me, and we need to move on up. We need to, Weezy, we need to go on up. But I'm just letting you know, we got to understand that God has blessed me because of attitude. And y'all, the other people are like, Weezy? YouTube it. Okay? So hear me, because we're moving on up. All right. In Mark chapter 2, I've got to read a verse just so I can say I did. Mark chapter 2, verses 2 through 5, and I'll leave you alone. It's my attitude and my blessing. My attitude has a lot to do with my blessing. Thank you. And straightway many were gathered together so much that there was no room to receive them. No, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. Say, Jesus preached. Thank you. And they came unto him bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. Verse 4. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was, and when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. Last one. Did I read 5 or just 4? 5, okay, thank you. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee.
Amen.
Hear me for just a second. Hear me for just a second. Many of our attitudes would have been that Jesus doesn't have time for me. I'll catch him some other time. He's preaching all around this place. I'll catch him at another time. Another attitude would have been, I knew I wouldn't get to see him. I don't even know why I wasted my time. I knew he wouldn't take care of me. Listen, if he really wanted to heal me, he would have come to me.
Yeah.
Oh, that's sitting right at home because it got quiet. But their attitude was this, that Jesus is busy, so how can I make it easier for him to get to our friend? How can I make it easier for Jesus to get to him? Listen, their attitude was not, he ain't got time for me. His attitude was, we got to find a way.
Amen.
And so we got to understand this. We got to find a way to get to where God would have an easier path to get to me. Listen, a good place to get to God and have an easier path is if you fall on your knees and pray.
Amen.
Fall on your knees and pray. Here's the attitude that we should walk in. God loves me.
Amen.
Oh, dear God,
amen.
The attitude everybody in this church under the sound of my voice ought to understand and ought to walk in is this, that God loves me. He loves me so much that even when I was going through something, that thing was only temporary. But God loved me for eternity. He loves me eternally. He will never stop loving me. And say, well, now, Brother Jeff. I love it when people say, Brother Jeff. Because they're fixing to come up with an excuse as to why God doesn't love them. No, Brother Jeff. If God loves everybody, then why does he allow people to go to hell? First of all, God gave you a way out of hell. He never intended any human being to go to hell. It was not created for humans at all. It was created for the devil and the angels that went with the devil. It was never intended for a human soul to ever be inside hell's gates. So don't tell me that God doesn't love everybody and lets people go to hell. No. What happens is this, is people allow themselves to get distracted, allow themselves to believe that other things other than what God gave us. God gave us the ability to be saved. God gave us the ability to be right with Him. And God loved us so much that He sent His Son to die for us that we would not have to go to hell. We could go to be in heaven with Him. God loved us that much that He sent Himself down here in the form of a man to die on a cross and people spit in His face and people pull out His beard and people hate Him and try crucifying Him when all He did was love them. And so don't tell me that God doesn't love you. God loves you more than you love yourself. God loves you more than you love your children. God loves you more than anything on this planet. He loves you. Listen, I will speak favorable about God's people and not curse them. I wish to God the church would get it. I will speak favorable. I don't care if they are the worst. Hear me? You can find something. They are good at something. They may be good at talking about people. I don't know. But they're good at something. Good at something. Listen, speak favorable about God's people and not curse them. I will bless the people of God, for with what blessing I pour out, I will have it returned to me. That was worth the price of admission. What I pour out gets brought back to me. I'm trying to hurry. I said, hurry, preacher. That's okay. I said to say. I will bless the people of God, for with what blessing I pour out, I will have it returned to me. Many of us would call David too short, too young. He smelled like sheep. He didn't look like a king. He didn't act like a king. He danced before all the people, and so much so that his wife got so mad at him. She said, I hate you. He said, I don't care. I hate you too. He didn't really say that. But he said, I don't care if you like what I do or not. I haven't yet to, I have not even started to defile myself before the Lord. I'm going to dance before the Lord, whether you like it or not. Just a matter of fact, I ordered me some new dancing shoes. I'm just letting you understand. I'm just letting you know that David didn't look like everybody else thought he ought to look like. But this is what God said. God said, you're just the right size. You're just the right age. You smell like a shepherd to me. Oh, you smell like a shepherd out of smell. Listen, he looked like what God saw as a king. God saw differently. Now, we have to have an attitude of this. You can't do this. You're not good enough. You're not this. You're not that. That's religion. God says this. You're just the right size. You're just the right age. You smell just like I wanted you to smell. You act just like I wanted you to act. For a matter of fact, I'm going to dance with you. And so here, I just let you understand what God has in mind in store for you.
Yes.
He doesn't have cursing in store for you. He has blessing in store for you. And I'm quitting. He has blessing in store for you. He loves you no matter what you think or what the devil's told you or some slick-haired, shiny-shoe preacher told you. God loves you.
Amen.
No matter what, he loves you. You can go to hell and he'll still love you. I was going to use Jonah, but I won't. Don't have time. Maybe some other time. Jonah. Oh, I'd love to preach it. But I'm not. You may be going through something this morning. Maybe you don't understand what God's doing. And I totally agree. And there's sometimes I'll think of God and say, God, what? That's not disrespectful. That's me going, what? I'm not trying to be disrespectful to God at all. You may have sin you're struggling with. And you feel like God has forgiven you so many times. He's tired of forgiving you. That's not true. Here's a sure way to find out if God still loves you. If he's still dealing with you when you sin. When you still feel that tug on your heart, when you know you're not right, God's still dealing with you. Here's another way. If it's been so long since you have heard from God and you prayed and I just don't feel like anything, if you'll finally get alone with God, I guarantee you that tug will come back. It's not over till the trumpet sounds. It's not even over then. The song. There will be some saved in the tribulation period. I feel sorry for them. If you can't live for God now, how are you going to live for Him then? When all hell is broken loose. Your attitude may be this, that maybe you let God down. You can't let God down because you don't hold Him up. Maybe you feel like you've let God down. You haven't let God down. Your attitude will greatly determine how you proceed with God. How are you going to proceed with Him? This is how. You may see yourself as a sorry, no good sinner that just can't get it right. Can I tell you how I see you when I look out? I see you saved. I see you blessed. I see you a leader. I see a witness for God. Because whatever you come out of is what you can help somebody else come out of. That's who I see. Bow your head with me, please. Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father. Just bless myself with this. I thank you for this group of people. I thank you for this wonderful crowd of people that you brought here today. Father, change our attitude as a church. Change our attitude as individuals. We are not the lowest of the low or the lowest rung on the stool. We're not. We are children of a living God. If you're here this morning and you don't know this Jesus, would you please give me the honor of introducing you to Him? He calls me Jeff. I call Him Jesus. I love Him. I love Him this morning.
And all that is within me, bless His name.
If you know this song, sing it with me.
Bless the Lord.
Listen. If you're here and you say, Brother Jeff, I don't know this Jesus, would you please just raise your hand and say, Brother Jeff, please, I don't know him. I'd like to know him. I need to know him. I want to know him. I know God loves me, but I'm just away from him. Brother Jeff, just please pray with me. And I promise you, I'll pray with you. We won't drag you by the hair to the altar, I promise you. We're not going to sit on you until you admit, until you confess all your sins. We're not going to do any of that. I'm going to introduce you to Jesus and let you know that he loves you more than anything in this world. Fine. If our hearts are clear, that's great. I'm glad. I don't know if it's true, but I'm glad that you think it's true. You hear me? We're going to be dismissed now. A word of prayer. I know that God gave me this message for today. I know he gave it to me for this group of people. But he does not waste words. Some of us are in the crosshairs. Some of us at a fork in the road. We can either live for God or we cannot. And time is running out. People, listen to me. Time is running out to be playing games with God. Jesus is looking. He sees those that are lost and dying and damned without any hope. And he pricks our hearts and he tries to pull us. Because it's not God's will for you to be cursed. It's not God's will for you to go to hell. It's God's will for you to be blessed and you be right with him. No, maybe you won't do everything perfectly, but you know what? God knows that. And he called you anyway. He knows that about me, and he called me anyway. Love you this morning. Bow your head with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. I thank you for this wonderful group of people that you've allowed me to be the pastor of. You're so awesome to me, and you're so wonderful to me. I pray, God, that your words not fall to the ground, but they go in the very heart of your people. Father, we thank you for your blessings. Father, as we travel today, God, we are not here in your presence anymore, but for this evening, God, we'll be here this evening as we go to our daily activities and our daily jobs and daily whatever we have to do today. I pray you keep your hand upon us in the name of Jesus. Bring us back safely tonight, together one more time in your presence, to be in this house one more time. And Father, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You're dismissed this morning.